We want to turn our attention to, I have to say, is one of the worst things I've read in quite some time. That's NPR just put out a report, the title of which is "The Government's Own Experts Found Barbaric and Negligent Conditions in ICE Detention." Very tough read, but we are very honored to be joined here by Silky Shah, who's the executive director of the Detention Watch Network, to talk more about this. Silky, thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here with you both.
Well, we are really happy to have you, even though what's bringing us here is just, well, I guess it's not unbelievable, but outrageous. For those who haven't seen, I don't even really know how to describe it. I just will read this very quickly. There's an examination of two dozen ICE facilities, and they found negligent medical care, unsafe and filthy conditions, racist abuse of detainees, inappropriate pepper spraying of mentally ill detainees, and other problems that in some cases contributed to detainee deaths. Maybe I know the answer to this question, Silky, but I guess my first question for you was, I mean, were you surprised by any of what has been revealed in this report?
Sadly, I wasn't actually that surprised by this. I think I've been working on immigrant detention for over 20 years now, and the stories are stories we've heard for years. And I think what is shocking most is how much this administration is ignoring what's happening in immigrant detention right now. So I really appreciated this reporting coming out, really shedding light, showing what we all know, experts seen, the complaints that are happening inside the system, a lot that hasn't been exposed, that has to be forcefully exposed to sort of learn about what's happening, the abysmal conditions. Many people have died in detention over the years. And that's the worst of the system, but people are constantly put into segregation, into solitary confinement. People are constantly, you know, denied medical care. People are sexually abused, physically abused. So much racism within the system, trauma that lives with them, even if they are outside of detention. And, you know, when you look at the scope of the system, you have hundreds and thousands of people who've been subject to detention over the years. And so it's not this narrow thing that's happening. It's actually happening to tens of thousands of people right now. And over the course of the years, even more. So I wasn't surprised, but I think it was important and harrowing to read the level of what came out of these reports. And hopefully it can actually have some attention again on this system that received a lot of attention under the Trump administration, but for in many ways, this administration has done a bit, but hasn't done enough to really address what's happening in immigrant detention and start closing down even more detention facilities.
You know, so much of what was in this really, I mean, it's shockingly horrific, and we can get into some of the details, but some of what I found interesting was the fact that so much of this just sounds what unfortunately is so typical of the U.S. prison system. So it does seem like this horrific prison system that we have to the U.S. is just being applied to people who are being put in detention for supposedly, you know, whatever, quote unquote, violating immigration laws. Not always, but, you know, we know that the immigration system in the U.S. has become in many ways like a carceral system. I'm just curious what you have to say about that, about the way that the situation around immigration has become an issue of like criminalizing people being able to, you know, come to the U.S. And just by nature, like that exposes people to a system that in the U.S., I mean, this is what the criminal justice system unfortunately looks like.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's such an important point. I mean, I think a lot of people within immigrant rights movement are alarmed to see what's happening in immigrant detention, but it isn't actually that unique. This is what's happening to the 2 million people who are imprisoned in jails in the whole of the U.S. We see the U.S. as the world's leading incarcerator, and that has been applied to immigration and makes actually the way that immigration operates here unique in that carceral systems are used, and they're used for a lot of different reasons. In the story, they talk about how immigration detention is not meant to be punitive, and rather people are in detention just to await a hearing. You have so many people, hundreds and thousands of people who are in pretrial detention, pretrial jail in the U.S. all the time, not serving a sentence. And that's similar to immigrant detention. It's not So it's important to recognize the similarities between the systems. They are the same facilities. All of the many of these jails are county jails. Even the private prisons are usually former prisons, former state prisons or federal prisons that have been used that now immigrant detention is being used for. So immigrant detention is prison and jail. It's the same thing. It's not something unique or different in any way whatsoever. I think one thing that is unique is that people aren't, you know, similar to pretrial detention, people aren't serving a sentence. So they're there indefinitely. Sometimes people will spend 2 weeks in jail in immigrant detention. Sometimes they'll spend years or months, depending on what's happening with their case. And that's really harrowing when you think about these facilities that are meant for short-term stays, no outdoor recreation, no ability to be in touch with loved ones, no ability to have the medical care or needs that you have. And so I do think it is so essential for the immigrant rights movement, for people who care about immigration, to understand that these systems are fully intertwined. They are the same system. Immigrant detention is a part of the prison industrial complex, and our ability to fight back is really reckoning with how the U.S. has become the world's leading incarcerator and uses prisons as a solution to a lot of problems, and has resulted in so many more people being incarcerated and dying in these facilities.
Yeah, no, really, it's, you know, some of the things, you know, someone was found to have HIV, they didn't tell him. There is a pregnant woman, they refused to check if she had an ectopic pregnancy. Someone with an open wound that received no care whatsoever. And when I was reading this, the thing that really struck me is that these reports were secret, that they actually, the government commissioned the reports, they got the information, and then, of course, it had to be forced out by journalists. And I mean, I guess, again, maybe this is a question I should know the answer to, but I mean, does that speak to how systemic this sort of mistreatment is? I think a lot of times people hear this sort of thing about prisons and they assume it's like one, you know, sadistic guard doing this terrible thing. But it seems like if you know this is happening across your system and you keep it secret, it's partially maybe because you want it that way. I don't know. Maybe I'm editorializing too much, but your thoughts there.
No, absolutely. It's completely systemic. It's intentional. ICE, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, lies, hides information all the time, does everything they can to keep the system going, to sort of juke the stats, so they say, like keep people in detention, say that they need more people in detention or need more money for detention because, oh, they're having to release people. The truth is, everybody in immigrant detention is there for administrative procedure. Anybody could be released at any given time. And the choices about who is in detention and who is not are completely arbitrary. And so this administration has a lot of power to release people from these really horrific conditions, but instead they continue to keep this system open and keep, you know, keep many people in these facilities, even when they have very, very many times said that people shouldn't be in these conditions, that people shouldn't be in private detention, but continue to use private detention facilities. And so I think, you know, I think that's absolutely right. It is very systemic. A lot of what is happening here, you know, this actually reminded me of a report that we did under the Obama administration many years ago called Fatal Neglect, where we took information from the Freedom of Information Act request, made a request, learned what was happening in some of these death reports, and saw that there were actually a whole number of negligent deaths that happened in the system that wasn't exposed. And we only got that information through FOIA. And after that, it showed actually similar cases, people not calling 911, not doing an HIV test, not doing the things that people needed that could have actually saved their lives, who were going through with alcohol withdrawal, other things that they needed particular support for, that we know how to do that. We have, you know, effective, you know, like we have medical resources that can support people, but instead we choose not to. And so I wasn't surprised by this, but it was alarming to see story after story after story and see what's happening and to see that the Biden administration isn't doing urgently what needs to be done, which is close down more detention centers.
Well, so I want to ask you a bit more about that, because you mentioned when we opened that, you know, a lot of this was sort of more in the public eye when Trump was president. And now, you know, it is true. People look away more, particularly liberals who did seem to care more about immigration when Trump was president. But obviously this is a bipartisan problem. Is there any, I mean, okay, so it's great this report came out, but there's been so many reports, right? Like, it's not the first one. Right. It's not the first time that we hear. and see documented horrific like stories and lots of evidence of people being sexually assaulted in these facilities, you know, people being just, you know, neglected medically, all of the things that are in this report, not the first time. It's horrible, but not the first time. So then it becomes an issue of what's to be done. Are there people inside government, inside the Senate, inside the House trying to do something about this? Like, where are our allies in this? Do we do? Like, those of us who care, what do we do? That's my big question. I know you probably don't have the exact answer, but.
Yeah, no, I mean, I will say there, you know, we've taken sort of two approaches to addressing what's happening with the system. One is fighting at the local level. So many of our wins have actually happened in communities that have immigrant detention centers that are fighting for their loved ones. One of the sort of data that we've discovered is that actually when a detention center is in a community, people are more likely to be targeted because, again, it's very arbitrary. So they're saying, oh, we have these 600 beds open. We need to sort of consider who's in the area. How can we make sure to fill those beds? They have guaranteed minimums built into the contracts, meaning they have sort of like quotas where ICE is essentially paying regardless of, you know, what the need is or not, quote unquote, need is or not. And so we know more and more that the existence of detention facilitates and encourages deportation. And we've actively said, okay, let's close down detention centers, stop future expansion. And we've been really successful at the local, state, and federal level in places like New Jersey and Illinois. We've actually been successful at ending detention contracts. The Biden administration has ended 5 detention contracts, and that's because of pressure from advocates, pressure from people who were detained and fought for their lives, from pressure from organizers and loved ones. And so that rising up is so essential. Additionally, we've been really trying hard to reduce the amount of money going to Immigration and Customs Enforcement and Customs and Border Protection, the Department of Homeland Security, so much money. I mean, I think a lot of people think about the post 9/11 era, and a lot of these policies were very much baked in already. As Rania, you mentioned, you know, this is a part of mass incarceration. We saw all these policies and all these laws change in the 80s and 90s, but it was after 9/11 that so much more money was funneled into the system, and that we ended up having this sort of like fortress state model that we have now, where so much money goes to border militarization and the immigrant detention system. And so a lot of our efforts are to try to reduce that amount of money and to say, no, you can't have more money for this system. We have to move away from this. And in terms of our allies, we did see changes. And I know the Biden administration has been very hypocritical on this issue, especially when it comes to the issue of private prisons. But because of our efforts, they did end contracts at a number of facilities. And that's important to keep in mind. They have the power to do that. And we can continue to push them to do that. And there's actually some contracts ending soon, and we're trying to push them in Elizabeth, New Jersey, where there's a private prison. The Biden administration is fighting back to keep that prison, but we're doing a lot to say, actually, no, you shouldn't be doing this. And so I think a lot of what people can do is push their members of Congress to support detention center closure, push their members of Congress to say, we don't want more funding going to Immigration and Customs Enforcement and Customs and Border Protection, and really push for policies. You know, there's a bill in Congress called the New Way Forward Act that actually would repeal a lot of the policies that lead to mandatory detention and criminalization of migration. And we really eventually want to get to that point that we can pass that.
Mm-hmm. Well, Silky, before we let you go, I assume many people who will read reports like this will be moved to action. Where can they find Detention Watch?
Yeah, absolutely. Our website is detentionwatchnetwork.org, and we are also on Twitter, or whatever it's called now, at Detention Watch, and also on Instagram. And so please reach out. We're ready to help and support folks who are trying to fight the system.
Right on. Well, thank you so much, Silky Shah, Executive Director of the Detention Watch Network. Thank you so much for being with us here on the Freedom Side.
Thanks so much for having me.